When Museveni came into power, looking for votes in Kasese, he demanded for the resettlement of the salt factory.
Once.
Just the ladies.
Yes.
So let her talk.
That's it, the ladies. When you eat this salt, it becomes very wet.
For sure, it's true. Animals are for preservation of heads and skins.
It's really salty.
When you are, the Germans were not making real salt. It was just camouflage because, you know, that time, I mean, it was brutal. Last year, the Chinese were here in the water.
And they got good.
So hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel. Now currently we are at Lake George.
So we are on Kazinga Channel, and Kazinga Channel shows attract a lot of wildlife in Queen Elizabeth National Park. It is the nearest and easy to reach water body in the park, and it is a wide, long natural channel that links two freshwater lakes, that is Edward and Lake George.
Safety is key, even right here as we're having fun. Safety is key, and I think you can see all these boats. We have life jackets all over here, so we'd recommend that if you're coming, don't worry about coming or carrying your own life jacket. You have all the boats here having life jackets.
The channel is the dominant attraction in the whole of Queen Elizabeth, and it has two parts, the North Kazinga and the Kasenyi Plains. Both parts of Kazinga Channel are very cool points for viewing game. Kasenyi Plains are ideal for lion tracking.
They go beyond 220, because after giving birth, gestation period is 24 months. These are 2 years. Then after 2 years, it has to stay with the young one for 5 years again, then conceive. This is why we say they give only birth to 6 times. Wild animals rarely give birth, twins. Very rare. I've seen twins from the elephant on the channel here. I've seen twins of the hippos as well. So most of the wild animals, they never have twins. It can be either with the hippos or with the elephant, and it has to be with enough milk to breastfeed the young one, the twins anyway. Apart from that, then it either has to lose one of them or lose all of them.
When all buffaloes are chased from their herds, they find comfort at the shores of Kazinga Channel, and during the boat cruise, we saw a number of individual buffaloes bathing in the mud. It is termed as the most popular tourist area in Uganda due to the many activities that visitors can do when they visit Queen Elizabeth National Park. Now, Kazinga Channel is bordered by the Lake George on the eastern side, and Lake George is one of the largest freshwater lakes in Uganda with many tributaries from Mountain Rwenzori. Lake George is responsible for the drainage of Kazinga Channel and the adjacent Lake Edward. Now, during the boat cruise, you will get a chance to see fishing villages overlooking the stream, such as the Kasenyi Plains. You are able to see fishermen washing their fishing nets in the river. The channel is well seen from the boat cruise, and the boat cruise is operated between 11 a.m. in the morning to 1 p.m. in the afternoon, that is in the local time. It also has an evening cruise that starts from 3 p.m. up to 5 p.m. in the local time.
So there's a safari lodge being put in place here, but this is a very nice viewpoint where you can be able to view the entire, should I call it a landing site? But that is the whole village, like in view, because we were along that Kazinga Channel. There's a bridge around there, and then past that bridge, we continue up to the other extreme end, and this is where most of the cars are parked when guys come here for the Kazinga Channel boat ride. We park around here, and a number of restaurants here, so you can be able to get a food, a meal at a very average price, like around 15,000 Ugandan shillings. You can be able to get yourself fish. So we are here for like a few more minutes before we set off. Next, we'll be going to Lake Katwe. I'll be showing you what's happening around Lake Katwe.
After experiencing Kazinga Channel, we had to head off to Lake Katwe. And Lake Katwe is an ancient lake in the southwestern part of Uganda in Queen Elizabeth National Park.
We're meant to be doing a tour here, but when I look at the weather, it's cloudy, as you can see. It's really drizzling, and we're not sure how much of the tour we'll be able to see, because we're meant to see how the salt is mined. We're meant to interact with the people that mine the salt. But basically, you can see that the water levels have actually risen all over. This water never used to stop here. It used to stop like it was a little bit lower. And if you look at that particular thing standing there, not sure what it's called, but the levels are much lower than they are right now. It's like heavily raining here, but I wish I could be able to show you more. However, because of the rain, unfortunately, I won't be able to show you a lot more. It's been a wonderful experience. If you've not been to Queen Elizabeth National Park, well, you have a very big opportunity to come and experience it. Because we're coming here amidst the pandemic. Because of the rain, guys, I'm going to have to just run back into the van. So, catch you later. We finally made it to Lake Katwe, and this is where they mine salt from. We had to stop somewhere because of the rain, but we're glad we're able to make it up to here. So basically what you're seeing, all of these places are demarcations of different salt miners, and according to a local tour guide here who's experienced, who's grown up here, he's been giving us a little bit of history about this particular place and the process which they follow to mine. I think I'll be dropping that around somewhere.
So, ladies and gentlemen, you're most welcome. So now, the other point you can see, that is not the volume of water, that's the main lake, Katwe Explosion Crater. And that lake was formed 500 million years ago after the continental drift theory. Then to our local culture, they say it was discovered by the Vatures. I don't know if it's true, but for us, the geography will say it was formed by explosive volcanistae 500 million years ago after the continental drift theory. So when the lake was being formed, there are some chemical sedimentary rocks which were formed and were raised to the middle part of the circumference of the lake. So being the fact that it was like a bomb because it's explosive, those rocks developed lines of weakness, okay? Because they are salty. Now we have got a physical geographical relationship between Mount Rwenzori and our lake here. Mount Rwenzori has got many sac glaciers. That are blue ranges you can see. That's Mount Rwenzori. So having those sac glaciers, our part here in Kasese, we are crossed by the snow by the equator at 0 degrees. So when you go to Kasese, the other side as your own Fort Portal, you'll see that equator part. So now when the heat heats up the snow will melt and form some fresh water in the form of rivers. Some of the rivers will go to Lake George and feel that depression and flow through Lake George to the Lake Edward via the Kazinga Channel and continue to the north, where it forms and joins the Albert Nile and continues up the Mediterranean Sea in Egypt. But before it enters the sea, it will form a feature we call a delta before it enters the main sea. That is in Egypt in the north. But for the case of Lake Katwe, some of the rivers will flow into Lake Katwe through those exposed sedimentary rocks which were exposed during massive explosive volcanism. So now we have got some inlets like Kasabuni, Chawamba, Kanyamiomba and ETC. So those rivers, after interacting through those lines of weakness of the chemical sedimentary rocks, they turn and form what you call salty water. Are we together? So when it forms the salty water, it is the very water that will evaporate and form crystallization. But for the sake of the main lake, once the crystals are formed, they are diluted by the fresh water because it is what continuous. And the fine crystals will sink gently to the other original chemical sedimentary rocks and make it a renewable resource. Now, you can imagine these diagrams like fish ponds. These are what you call the salt ponds, and they are under what you call artificial or man-made features on Lake Katwe. The salt ponds are formed by we people here. You can even form it here, so long as the town council gives you some permission. Just get a hand hoe or an excavator, you make a what? A salt pan, like the way you can dig a fish pond. So what we do, after you have made that hole, you get a water pumping machine. put it there, get water, pump it, and put it to the salt pan. So you, it is you the determinant to put the level of the water you want. So when the water reaches the salt pan, it contains what you call dissolved sodium and chlorine ions. Are we together? So they will have evaporate and charge. So in that process of evaporation, the crystals will neutralize each other in that process to form salt and water. So the crystal will be formed on top of water, and you come with a basin or a spade to cut out what you call deposition. Deposition is where you stand like in a corner or the edge of the salt pan, then you start pouring water. Then the water, so the crystals will have to sink gently. Then the following day also come again. So it will behave like a cream of milk. When you boil milk on a sigiri, put it down, the way it is condensing or cooling, something that appears on top, it is the way that reflects here. It becomes like a cream. So it is a crystal you have to deposit gently using a spade. After some time, after 7 days actually, those layers will be mature for extraction.
How many days?
7 days.
Only 7 days?
7 days. You start clapping hands, you know, akasende, kaze. Akasende. So now, after some time, that's how the process is what? Is done and concludes.
So you just have to put your water, just water.
Just put water, yeah. Then besides that, I wanted to give you some information. The ones you can see, like grasses covering something, those are the heaps of salt waiting for market. And mind you, in the main lake, we only have one type of salt. That black thing you can see. I think that block, those locks, covered with vivera. For us in Lunyanko, they call it a chonde. You put it in beans. So it's a product where men go and extract it using iron bars. You go bare, go walking, because the lake is shallow. Use iron bars. This is one of it. You have very good soda ash. So this is the what? The magad maul. This is the one. At the same
time, get it from the lake itself, not from.
Yeah, from the main lake.
They just walk in and get it.
Yeah, because the lake is what? It's shallow. Okay. Yeah, so as you are moving, you feel it that it's what? It's under because it is tangible. So get your iron bar, you start carving it like wood carving in art. The broken parts, raise them, bend and pick them gently. Put them on the, I think some brown trees the other side. Those brown trees are what you call the ambush wood trees. The ambush wood trees, they grow on the shores of Lakes Edward and George, even the Kazinga Channel. And they are thorny to reduce the rate of transpiration. And the reason why you use them here, they contain a spongy mesophyll 100%, which makes them less dense than water. So they float, it's like a paper. It appears bigger, but weightless. So when you break these locks, bend and pick them, because you have to avoid your head from getting water immersed. Then pick them, put it on those very trees. So at the end of the day, when you get a large heap, you just say, I'm done. Because you are self-driven.
So you just bend into the lake and
you go moving. Wherever you feel that the rock is, get your iron bar, start carving it. Then raise it using the gumboot, bend and pick it. Because there is hydrogen sulfide gas, which deforms the human skin cells. So you have to protect your head. Get me?
So these other parts are already affected, the downer one?
No, not as such, but of course after some long time, you have to find that your body has got a lot of scars everywhere. Actually, that's why we don't allow women to go and work in the main lake. Women only maneuver within the salt pans because the water is very shallow, just 2 feet or 1.5. Actually, you the owner, it is you the determinant to put the water you want. So women, as they're working, the water will not reach the what? The private parts. So you can still maneuver from there. So more uses of this salt is that we also use it as a raw material for making soap. Mokwano factory comes with vehicles to buy this rock salt. At the same time, it helps put color in textile industries like Nyanza textile industry will use it to put color. The artists know what I'm meaning. Thirdly, we also use it for animals. Animals eat it. So when the animals are eating it, even appetite, the prolactin hormones, which are responsible for the milk letdown in both human beings and cattle, it becomes very quick. The result sharpens. It becomes high.
Catalyzes.
Efficient. It's
and
like a churungo. So the milk letdown becomes very active.
One.
Yes.
Do what?
Please explain.
Let her talk.
The ladies, when you eat the this salt. Come very wet.
Yeah. Yeah.
This salt gets a lot of meat. Okay. What about you?
For sure, it's true. This is in two phases. For the animals and for preservation of hides and skins.
It's really salty.
When you are slaughtering an animal at the slaughtering slab roof,
there's someone who wants to see
the skins and hides are presented on the ground.
Salt.
Then you mash that salt.
Really salt.
Then the skins will be prevented from bacteria and germ what? Infections. So it's very important. Okay. And for your information, most of the people come from Chiruhula, even Burundi, Rwanda to buy our salt from here. That's very expensive. Then we only farm salt during the dry season. Within the rainy season, no formation of salt. And actually, during the rainy season, salt becomes very expensive. But during the dry season, you find the sack is like at 2,000, 3,000, but in the rain, 20,000. The flamingos come from Lake Nakuru
in Kenya.
Yeah, so why they come here? They have got a special food we call red algae in biology. So that red algae, it is scientific that when it rains here, because Lake Manyanyanga is a seasonal lake, explosion crater, when it rains, their bodies respond to the stimuli and know that the red algae is what? Present. So they come and fly. Reaching here, when they feed on that red algae, it turns their feathers from white to pink color. So as they are turning the color, they become attractive to each other and carry out honeymoon. They met. Chiringo muda isi gabulunji. Ah, nakamba. Ah, makasa ya nyiri la. Nange mwe gombi yego. So, after that, they change the route and go to Lake Natron in Tanzania, where the nesting is done. Can you imagine? Where the nesting is done. So after incubation, the young ones go to Lake Nakuru. So the flamingos are termed to be migratory birds within East Africa. So they come here for food, that's the major point. Two, honeymoon. That's how some second scientists are saying.
So they be on honeymoon?
A honeymoon, of course, but the major reason it is food. And they first send some scouts to see, is the food enough? If some of them don't go back, you know, there is more food, then let's go. So I was trying to say, when the factory collapsed, when Museveni came into power, looking for votes in Kasese, he demanded for the resettlement of the salt factory. So the government of Uganda had to invite some Kushites, scientists from Egypt, to come and make an inventory here. The Kushites said the Germans were not making real salt. It was just camouflage because, you know, that time, I mean, it was brutal. So they said, let's go in the form of helping people. And yet you are taking what? Other minerals like gold and ETC. And to verify that one, last year the Chinese were here in the water.
And they got gold?
Yeah, you know China is modifying this manufacture of electric trains and electric car batteries and whatever. Mm-hmm. So the raw materials got from salt lakes. It's called lithium. So
Wakanda.
They have been here, about 20 Chinese.
Those Germans were stealing.
They were
stealing it, but they didn't tell Amin.
Because once Amin gets the leakage, firing squad, even in Zambia.